Good evening, everybody. The Great Moon Hoax. So, perhaps to put us in the picture, we'll just remind ourselves what supposedly happened 52 years ago. Of course, that is not the version that they broadcast in the end. That was take one. You probably saw take two, or take three, or take four. That's the premise of the talk, that the moon landings were hoaxed, and what you think you saw, whether they be images or videos or cinefilm or whatever, that wasn't filmed on the moon. It was filmed either in Hollywood soundstage or possibly in Area 51, depending on which particular flavour of conspiracy theory you believe in. But the basic idea was the moon landings were hoaxed. Not necessarily spaceflight, but the moon landings themselves. So where did this moon hoax start? Why do people believe that the Americans would hoax such a thing? Well, the hoax started because Kennedy made a promise.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth. No single space project in this period will be more impressive to mankind or more important for the long-range exploration of space. And none will be so difficult or expensive to accomplish.
So yes, definitely impressive, definitely important, but difficult and expensive. And it is said that Kennedy and his advisors simply underestimated how difficult and how expensive it was going to work out to be. So everything looked rosy in the early 60s, but by the mid-60s, people began to realise we cannot do this, and therefore the hoax was perpetrated. And from that point on, what you think you saw in terms of actually going to the moon and landing on the moon were all faked. So in other words, the Saturn V did indeed exist. The Saturn V rocket has put men into space. It's a little difficult to fake something like that when millions of people have seen it live. And yes, man has been into space. There's no denying that the International Space Station exists now, for instance, and there's no denying that astronauts were put into Earth orbit back in the 1960s. Here we see a picture of the Apollo hardware being tested out in Earth orbit. So yes, that, everybody agrees, did happen. But from that point onwards, that's where we disagree. So in other words, that it is claimed is not a picture of the lunar module on the surface of the moon. It looks like a giant airfix kit because it is a giant airfix kit sitting in a soundstage somewhere. There's not even any stars in the background, so clearly that's a fake. And later missions, again, you look at that. Can you really believe that's the surface of the moon? It looks like this guy is walking around in plaster of Paris or something, and even the background looks like cardboard. So can you actually believe any of this stuff? So let's look at the evidence piece by piece and let's see how much of it stands up to scientific scrutiny. If somebody is going to claim that this event never took place and here's all the evidence, the World Wide Web is full of web pages that claim to present evidence that the moon landings did not take place. And so what we're going to do, because I'm a scientist, I thought this will be interesting. Let's look at the evidence they present and see how much of their evidence does stand up to scientific scrutiny. Computers weren't up to the task, it is said. Radiation would kill the astronauts, it is said. We're going to look at a few video clips and look at a few images that are claimed to be impossible or clear evidence that they were filmed on Earth rather than on the surface of the moon. We're not going to cover every shred of evidence that's ever been presented. By looking on web pages, for instance, I figured that was the evidence that most people would be exposed to. By the time I got to 100 pieces of evidence, 100 images, 100 videos, 100 quotes, I sort of gave up counting. So there are far too many individual pieces of evidence to actually look at, so I'm just going to pick a few to keep this talk under the 3-hour mark, if that's okay with you. So computers were too big. They couldn't possibly fit a computer inside the spacecraft that was powerful enough to do anything. This is a picture from, I'm not sure exactly which year, probably the late 50s, shortly before Kennedy made the promise. And yes, computers did take up a volume of order the size of a large room, and it took a few people to operate the computer. So how did NASA get around this problem? This is the Apollo guidance computer. You can sort of judge its size by bearing in mind there's a keypad on the right-hand side, but that keypad is fairly chunky because it has to be operated by an astronaut, even though they're wearing gloved hands, which they will for some of the trip. And the computer itself is inside that metal box, a copper shield, to protect it from radiation. And it's often been said that whatever that was, it was not up to the task of navigating people from the Earth to the Moon and allowing them to land with an accuracy of perhaps a few tens of metres. Is that a misunderstanding of the amount of power in the computer? Well, not necessarily, because the computer was, by today's standard, a very poor performer. If we compare it with, I don't know, a tablet, for instance, an iPad, or if you compare it with a laptop, this computer was able to do calculations perhaps 10,000, perhaps 100,000 times more slowly than a laptop that you might be looking at the moment. So in other words, your laptop might be 100,000 times more powerful in terms of the number of calculations that it can perform in 1 second compared to the Apollo guidance computer. And how much information could be stored in the Apollo guidance computer? There, that's less than the amount in your laptop by something perhaps of order 1 million. Your laptop can contain 1 million times as much information as could be stored in the Apollo guidance computer. So saying that the computing wasn't up to the task is not getting it wrong in terms of the capability of the hardware. It's what was that supposed to do? The function of the Apollo guidance computer was effectively navigation. It was to solve Newton's laws of motion. These were worked out 400 or so years ago, and it's the sort of thing that we get our first year undergraduate students to do in the first week of their first semester of their first year, and we usually get them to do the calculations by hand. The actual calculations required are effectively, if we are at this particular point in space, moving in this direction, and we've got a certain rocket engine behind us with a certain amount of thrust, how long do we have to fire the engine, and in which direction, in order to get to where we want to be, i.e. the moon, in 3 days' time? That's effectively the calculation that the Apollo guidance computer was doing. If it took a couple of seconds to come up with an answer, that's no big deal. The fact that your laptop could come up with the answer in a microsecond is neither here nor there. The Apollo guidance computer was up to the task. Remember, it didn't have to run Windows, it didn't take 2 minutes to reboot. It was an altogether slower machine, but it didn't have the cumbersome burden of having to deal with a very complex operating system. It's sometimes said that the actual computer they used was approximately the computing power of a musical Christmas card. That's probably about right in terms of the number of calculations it could do. So NASA basically wanted to get that into a box a certain size, so they went to the computer scientists and computer engineers at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology and said, basically, build us a computer that will take us to the moon. And by the way, you've got 5 years to do it, and here's a shedload of cash. And that basically got the job done. So claiming that the guidance computer wasn't up to the task is simply misunderstanding the job that was needed. What about radiation would kill the astronauts? Well, there are indeed charged particles streaming out of the sun, and they get trapped by the Earth's magnetic field, represented here by these dotted lines, and they end up in these donuts, these little light blue donuts, called the Van Allen radiation belts. So yes, there are very energetic particles trapped around the Earth. And it is said that astronauts on the way from the Earth to the Moon would receive a lethal dose of radiation. That's a misunderstanding. It is true that the Van Allen belts themselves, the radiation belts, are a lethal radiation environment, in the sense that if you stayed there, it would curtail your life quite dramatically. But the astronauts didn't stay in the radiation belts, they just passed through them on the way to the Moon. On this scale, the Moon would be a few metres away, and when leaving the Earth, the astronauts were travelling at some 25,000 miles an hour, so the length of time they would have been within the radiation belts would only have been something of order half an hour or an hour, something like that. And wherever possible, when NASA was sending the astronauts off to the Moon, they wouldn't send them on a trajectory that ploughed through the densest part of the radiation belts. Wherever possible, they would try and arrange it with the tilt of the Earth and the orbit of the Moon, such that the astronauts were sent through either the top or the bottom part of the Van Allen belts. They would clip through, hopefully, one of the lighter regions rather than the densest regions where most of the particles exist. During the time the astronauts were passing through the radiation belts, they would indeed have received a radiation dose, and that was monitored as they went along. The astronauts would have been told, yes, you are going to receive a radiation dose on your way out to the Moon and on your way back. And by the way, that's probably going to be the equivalent of a chest X-ray or two, and it might, in the fullness of time, later in life, increase your chance of getting a cancer by 1% or 2% or something like that. The astronauts would have understood the risk. Remember, they were effectively test pilots. And it wouldn't have been necessarily number one on their list of things to worry about. Remember, they're told that there's a chance that you might develop problems later in life because of your passage through a radiation belt. But do remember that we're going to put you on top of a 3,000-ton rocket full of rocket fuel. And by the way, the contractors who built the rocket put in the lowest tender. That's something to bear in mind when we're about to send you off into space. The idea of passing through a radiation belt was perhaps number 17 on their list of things to worry about. So radiation would have killed the astronauts. That's a misunderstanding of the fact that the astronauts didn't spend very long in that environment. Bear in mind both of these points. Computers weren't up to the task, and radiation would have killed the astronauts. Neither of these is actually evidence, even though it is on my list of evidence. It is not evidence because the people who say these things, computers weren't good enough, radiation would have killed the astronauts, that is a statement. It's not evidence, it's not proof. People don't come up with the evidence that backs up that statement. They simply make the statement. You could argue it's just their opinion, and their opinion is wrong. When you look at the evidence says that the computers were up to the task and radiation would not kill the astronauts. So those were just statements. Now let's look at a few actual pieces that are claimed to be evidence that the moon landings didn't take place. Let's look at a couple of videos.
Maybe it'll, that's what it looks like, it's waving in a breeze.
How many times can a man turn his head? Pretend that he just doesn't see. The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind. Yes, how many deaths will it take till he knows that too many people have died? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
Four clips there of flags that are blowing in the wind, whereas of course the moon has no atmosphere, and therefore you wouldn't expect to see flags blowing in the wind, unless this was a soundstage and somebody left a door open and then a breeze came in and made the flags flutter. But I ask you just to think briefly, what do those four clips have in common? When I asked this to a bunch of school children, I got one individual who said, the thing in common is that all the flags are the American flag, none of them are the Union flag. Which is true. The Union flag was not planted on the moon, that is for sure. But what I was getting at here is that these four clips all have astronauts manhandling the flag. They are either planting the flag or trying to straighten the flag or trying to unfurl the flag, and an astronaut is making it move. And once an astronaut has let go, the flag might continue to waggle backwards and forwards for a while, but then will be essentially static. So when you see things that look like flags flowing in the breeze, that's usually a result of the fact that somebody is actually making it move, and it just so happens that the movement that is effectively man-made just happens to resemble flags fluttering in the breeze. There we go. Let's have a look at another video, this time of the ascent stage of a lunar module leaving the moon, where you might expect to have the engine produce an exhaust plume out of the back. An initial blast, but no sign of a tongue of flame coming out of the engine. Why is it completely invisible? As we're now looking up towards the engine, we see a little dot implying the engine might be lit. But wouldn't we expect, if this thing is really accelerating the astronauts off the surface of the moon, wouldn't we expect some sort of an exhaust plume from the engine? If there's no exhaust plume, that's presumably because it's a model, and I guess it's on a fishing line, and somebody is simply reeling it in as the camera pans to see this object fly into the top of the studio. So why do we believe that there ought to be a tongue of flame? Because we think we know what rockets look like. That's what a rocket should look like. We all know what a Saturn V looks like. And look at that exhaust plume, white hot tongue of flame coming out of the back of those five F1 engines. And that's what we tend to think that all rockets should be like. We tend to think that all rockets should produce a very easily visible, bright exhaust plume. But one thing we have to bear in mind is, well, some rockets do, of course, produce that sort of plume, but it depends on the fuel that they are burning. The first stage of a Saturn V rocket is burning kerosene, sort of aviation fuel. And it's essentially a set of hydrocarbons, and the hydrocarbons are being burnt, and then those very hot molecules are coming out of the back and glowing white hot, and that's why we see a tongue of flame like that. If we had a different rocket fuel, for instance, what if we took hydrogen and oxygen as our fuel? What happens when you burn hydrogen and oxygen? The final byproduct, the exhaust plume, is hydrogen plus oxygen gives water, and water vapour is essentially transparent. So if you see an engine like the shuttle's engines burning hydrogen and oxygen, you can see essentially no exhaust plume. You look at the shuttle and you think, that can't be right. Look, it's absolutely obvious we can see something coming out of the back end of the shuttle there. Well, look more closely. You can see huge exhaust plumes coming from the solid rocket boosters, which, like the Saturn V, are burning material which is coming out white hot. But the shuttle orbiter itself is burning fuel which is coming from the external tank, the big orange tank there, which contains all the hydrogen and oxygen, and that's being fed to the shuttle's three engines. And what sort of exhaust plume do you see from these three engines, even though they are at full throttle? Well, it's essentially transparent, except you can see just a little bit of a shockwave because of the speed at which the exhaust plume is coming out. You see these little shock diamonds, these little sort of bluish triangles, which you can just about make out, but nothing like as bright as we tend to expect from the sort of fuels that we see in the solid rocket boosters and in the first stage of the Saturn V. So we have to bear in mind, whenever we're looking at an engine, we will not necessarily see a bright plume depending on which fuel is being used. So that video, again, is not that surprising. The video we saw of the ascent stage taking off from the surface of the moon. Let's switch from videos to a few images. This is what got me interested in the first place, because I'm quite interested in looking at images and trying to figure out if images, what information images tell you, and I was curious to know whether or not there was any evidence of fakery in any of these images. So this particular image has been shown many times, and it's claimed that these are impossible shadows. If the sun is the only source of light illuminating this scene on the surface of the moon, it should not produce the sort of shadows that we see in this image. Now, yes, I know that the Earth is in the sky as well, so the sun is shining on this scene and the Earth is shining on it as well, but just like the sun is very much brighter than the full moon as seen from Earth by a factor of perhaps a million or something like that, so the sun will be very much brighter than the Earth in the sky as seen from the moon. So we would not expect to see multiple shadows, a shadow produced by the Earth and a shadow produced by the sun. So we would only expect to see shadows produced by the sun. And over the distance we're looking at here, the sun is effectively an infinite distance away compared to the few hundred meters that we're looking at in this scene. So if the sun is essentially an infinite distance away, then all of the shadows that are produced by the sun should be essentially parallel. So they will either look parallel or they will appear to converge to the sun, just like the converging railway lines or motorway lanes when you see it going off into a vanishing point into the distance. But look at where the shadows are. We can't see the shadow of this particular astronaut. It doesn't seem to be visible. But we can see the shadow of the lunar module, and we can see shadows of rocks in the foreground. So let's draw a line where we think the shadow of the lunar module is. That would imply the sun is producing a shadow, so the sun is somewhere off to the left of this red line. But if we take the rock on the bottom right and draw its shadow, well, if a single source of light is producing both those shadows, that means that the sun must be there, which doesn't make sense. Not only that, but if we pick a different rock, it doesn't even converge to the same single source. So it is claimed these shadows are impossible for the moon, and the only explanation is that this was taken on a soundstage and different spotlights have been shone on different parts of the moon, or the moon's landscape, as it were. So there's one big spotlight shining on the lunar module, producing its shadow, and a different spotlight at a different angle is producing the shadows that we can see in the foreground. Well, that is one possible explanation for why those shadows look the way they do, that it's not taken on the surface of the moon, and it's taken with multiple spotlights. But there is another explanation. And in science, we often invoke this explanation or this ethos called Occam's razor. If there are two explanations for what you're looking at and one is an explanation that's much simpler than the other, then it's quite possible the simplest explanation might well be right. In other words, if you have to introduce a very complex explanation for what you're looking at compared to a really simple explanation, you're probably overdoing it. So, is there a simple explanation as to why the shadows might look the way they do? And kudos to the person who decided to answer this particular question by posting on the internet a nice explanation by taking a model on his kitchen table and showing that if you take a lunar lander and produce a shadow much like you see in the image, which is produced by a spotlight a long way off to the left of the table, you can tell the spotlight is a long way off because this felt pen, which is sitting on the table, also casts a shadow which is parallel to the shadow of the lunar lander. So if those shadows are parallel, you know that the light source is a long, long, long way off to the left. But what's in between the lunar lander and the felt pen? Well, we have a few rocks that are sitting not on the flat kitchen table, but they're sitting on this plasticine mound. And as a result, the shadows that are being cast are not falling on the flat table, they're falling on part of the slope of the mound. And hence those shadows, I hope you agree, look like the shadows that we can see in the image. They're at rather odd angles. This one, for instance, distinctly looks different in terms of not being parallel to the other two shadows. So it's simply a consequence of the fact that the moon's surface is not absolutely as flat as a formica kitchen table. It has a few lumps and bumps and mounds. We can't really prove that from the picture because it's a two-dimensional picture. It's not a three-dimensional image in which we can see all of the topography. But is it reasonable to believe that the moon has a little bit of an undulation and it's possible that there's a mound down there which is causing those shadows to appear the way they are? Well, that seems like a much more reasonable explanation than to say these shadows are impossible and can only have been produced by a studio set on Earth. Where are the stars? I showed you this picture a little earlier, and it's often been quoted as, you can tell this picture is fake because there are no stars in the sky. Now, we know that the moon has no atmosphere, so surely if you go to the moon with no atmosphere, the stars are going to be so much brighter than they are as seen from Earth. And surely any picture taken on the surface of the moon should show some stars in the background. Well, that's wrong for a couple of reasons, but one reason it's wrong is because if you think about taking away the Earth's atmosphere, does that make the stars so much brighter? Well, no, not really. The amount of light that's absorbed by the atmosphere, forget clouds just for the moment, on a clear night, the amount of light that's absorbed by the Earth's atmosphere is relatively small. I can't remember how many percent it is, but it's not like 10 times as much light would be coming down if we didn't have an atmosphere. The stars would be a few percent brighter if we took the atmosphere away. Not surprisingly, the atmosphere is quite transparent in the visible region. Of course, that's no coincidence. That's why we've developed eyes that are sensitive to the visible region, because most of the sunlight does make it to the Earth, to the surface of the Earth. So it's incorrect to say that on the surface of the moon, the stars would be much brighter. So if you say, okay, conceded, but surely if the stars were as bright as the surface, as seen from the surface of the Earth, wouldn't we expect them to be visible in the background? Well, anybody with a little knowledge of photography will know that if you're taking a picture in direct sunlight, and of course all the pictures on the surface of the moon were taken in sunlight, no clouds on the moon, so everything is nice and sunny, and we're taking a picture of a relatively bright object and a man in a white suit, so of course the exposure, the lens is going to be stopped down quite a bit, as you would do on a sunny day if you were taking a picture, and the exposure, I don't know, it might have been 1/1000th of a second or 1/500th of a second or something like that to expose that correctly. And if any of you have ever tried astrophotography, like this picture in the background of the Milky Way that I took a couple of years ago, anybody who's dabbled with astrophotography knows that when you're doing photography of the stars, you open up the lens as much as you can and you expose not for 1/500th of a second, you expose for many seconds or minutes or possibly hours in order to get a nice view of the stars. So it is no surprise whatsoever that if you take a picture in 1/500th or 1/1000th of a second with the lens stopped down, no surprise whatsoever that you don't see any stars. You can turn this question around and say, well, if a conspiracy theorist believes that that picture wasn't taken on the moon because there were no stars and it was actually taken in a studio sound set, you can ask the question back, well, why didn't NASA paint some stars in the background then? If you think it looks odd to have no stars in the background and you think that's odd, why didn't NASA deal with that by just painting some stars on the backdrop rather than leaving it absolutely jet black? And some conspiracy theorists would reply with, NASA didn't paint the stars in the background because they didn't want to get them in the wrong place. They didn't want some amateur astronomer coming along 50 years later saying, hang on a second, Arcturus is in the wrong place. It shouldn't be over there. It should be over there. Now, if you believe that NASA do not know where the stars ought to be at any given time, you have a very low opinion of NASA's capabilities. And perhaps it's not surprising that you don't believe NASA could possibly put a man on the moon. Why did astronauts leave footprints? Here's Aldrin on the surface of the moon, and he appears to have left footprints everywhere. So he has sunk into the lunar regolith, the soil if you wish, whereas the landing pad of the lunar module there doesn't seem to have gone 1 centimetre into the regolith. If we work out the mass of an astronaut and take into account he's got 100 kilos or something in his backpack, and we work out the size of his feet, we can work out the pressure that the feet are pushing down into the soil. And when we take the mass of the lunar module of 15 tons or so, minus the fuel that it took to get there, and think about the area of these four landing pads, we can work out the pressure under the lunar module. And it's very similar in the sense that you would expect an astronaut's foot to go down about as far as a lunar module's landing pad, roughly speaking. Yes, I know the gravity on the moon is 1/6 of Earth, but we're just comparing the astronaut with the lunar module, so it doesn't matter whether we're taking mass or their weight on the moon or their weight on Earth. So, somebody who presents this question and says, look, there's something wrong here, because look at this, why would an astronaut leave impressions in the soil but a landing pad wouldn't? The answer is, well, the landing pads do leave impressions in the soil, in the regolith, but not in that particular image. Here's one image where, for whatever reason, the landing pad didn't seem to sink much into this particular part of the regolith. There are plenty of other images in which it is obvious that the landing pad has gone quite a few centimetres into the regolith. It depends on exactly how much of the rock was covered with this fine dust, etc. So anybody who says, here's a picture and there's something wrong with it because the landing pad doesn't seem to be doing the right thing, what they generally do not do is to say, well, here's some other pictures which contradicts what I've just said. I have found that when you're talking to conspiracy theorists, they are very happy to present evidence which backs up their claim, but they are not too keen to acknowledge the existence of any evidence which counter argument, which basically provides counter-evidence for what it is they're trying to say. So yes, I am not showing every piece of evidence, I'm not showing every Apollo image, but what I'm not doing is presenting one image and saying this is typical of all images and we have to explain that one without acknowledging that other images give a convincing counter-argument. What about the cameras themselves? This is an Earthbound Hasselblad camera, and NASA went to Hasselblad, the Swedish camera maker, and said, can you make us some modifications of that to work with an astronaut? And it is strapped to the astronaut's chest. Let me make that bigger so we can see it more clearly. The camera is strapped to the astronaut's chest to make it easier. Sometimes they carry the camera around, but most of the time they leave the camera strapped to their chest to leave the hands free to do other things. It's been claimed that the cameras couldn't possibly be operated in very clumsy gloves. Well, Hasselblad tried to make that as easy as possible by making sure that the astronauts didn't have to grip the lens to focus it. There were paddles here to make it easier to push one way or push the other way. Remember, these are manually operated cameras. They had to set the focus, set the aperture, and set the shutter speed. And they simply did that by using a few rules of thumb and a little bit of practice at taking pictures of their family or their dog or something before going to the moon, just to get used to using these particular cameras. Notice also they have no viewfinder. The camera is strapped effectively on their chest, and they have, of course, a visor and a helmet. It's rather difficult to see down, and therefore, if there was a viewfinder, it really wouldn't help because they'd find it very difficult to see what was going on. So it's sometimes said, how on earth did they get the framing right if they couldn't see what was going on? We'll deal with that in just a second after we've dealt with these black crosses. You see them everywhere on these Apollo images, and their function is effectively twofold. In this particular case, because these crosses are very big and very widely spaced, you can tell that I've blown this image up because the crosses are separated by a certain amount. And you can tell that because I've only got four crosses, you can tell that I've cropped the image as well. So having those fiducial marks allows you to tell something about how large an object is in the field of view, and it can also tell you whether or not the image has been cropped or zoomed in. So those black marks are in the camera. Here's an image where, again, you see those black crosses. They are all over the image. One of them happens to be larger than all the others. Perhaps you can see it, perhaps you can't. But this one is about half as big again as all of the other images. And that's because that's the centre of the image. So you can tell that from the original image, I've cropped it because there's a lunar rover in the top part and boring rocks in the bottom part. So I've cropped it down. But the black crosses are made by the camera. So you can imagine if sunlight is hitting this scene, the light is coming through the lens of the camera. Before it hits the film, it goes through a glass plate onto which are etched all of these black crosses. So they get superimposed on every image. So the black crosses, of course, are in the camera. So this particular image has been pointed out, along with two or three others, as to what is going on here. If we blow it up so we can see it more clearly, the black crosses are in the camera. The black crosses cannot be behind any object in the field of view. And there you have a black cross which appears to be behind an object in the field of view. The object happens to be the white, the antenna of one of the part of the lunar rover there. And compared to just about every other image I've looked at where people say this is impossible, this can't happen, this is beyond explanation, this is the one image in which when I first looked at it, I thought to myself, yeah, you're right, that can't happen. What's going on here? And it took more than 30 seconds to figure out what was actually happening. And the answer actually doesn't really matter whether you're talking about film or whether you're talking about CCD modern digital cameras, the same effect can still happen. And yet again, rather than try and explain the theory, I think the best explanation is somebody who actually went into their back garden and showed how this particular effect can occur. They went into their back garden and photographed a greyish piece of card onto which is lying a whitish piece of card, and in front of both of them is a washing line, which is slightly out of focus, running across the image. You can hardly see it when it's in front of grass, but I hope that you can see that washing line quite clearly when it's in front of the grey card. But what happens when the washing line is in front of the white card? It almost disappears. It almost looks like the washing line has suddenly tucked itself behind the white piece of card. What's going on? Well, the white piece of card is overexposed. It's saturated. And when you have film and you are saturating the amount of light that can possibly go into one grain of the film, it tends to bleed into neighbouring grains and they start to turn white as well. So even though there should be a black line across the white is so saturated, some of the effect, the chemical change to certain grains of the film have bled into the region and filled in the black. If you've got a digital camera, each pixel of your camera gets full of electrons as light arrives at each pixel. If a pixel gets completely saturated and overexposed, the electrons fill up that pixel and they can avalanche and cascade into the neighbouring pixels, and they can make neighbouring pixels that should be black also look like they're white. And that is what's going on here. This is a completely saturated white area, and it's making that black area there look as if it's white because of the bleed from one grain of the film into the neighbouring grains. This idea of the black crosses looking a little bit like they've been hidden, that occurs on at least half a dozen different Apollo images, and in each case the black cross appears to be hiding behind something that is white and overexposed. Never hides behind a light grey or a dark grey or a mid-grey object, it only ever seems to hide behind a saturated white object. And the explanation is not immediately obvious, but with a bit of thought and a bit of digging, you can figure out what's actually going on. And again, kudos to the person who set up their experiment in their garden to show how it can happen. Coming back to the point I made a little while ago, if their cameras are strapped to their chests and they do not have a viewfinder, how do they get such perfect framing all the time? Well, one answer is to look at the NASA archive, and you'll find that there are a few images which were not framed very well, every once in a while an astronaut takes a picture of the inside of the spacecraft, which wasn't intentional. But in terms of pictures like that, the iconic picture of Aldrin on the surface of the moon, it's now, of course, 52 years old. And I would challenge anybody to say that they have never seen that picture before. OK, when I'm talking to some school kids, occasionally they admit to never having seen that picture. But I think everybody above a certain age must admit that at some point in the last 52 years, they have seen that picture before. Before I address the perfect framing, let me just quiz you by showing you a couple of images, the one I've just shown you on the right and one I showed you a few slides ago on the left. Clearly they are different. One has been cropped because the fiducial marks are further apart and the result is rectangular. So yes, I've cropped them slightly differently and clearly one is bigger than the other. I've done that to try and keep Aldrin roughly the same size in these two images. They were taken about 2 minutes apart, and you can see that Aldrin has changed his stance slightly. He's moved slightly round, he's raised his left arm, and he's now facing the camera rather than side onto the camera. But the sun is still coming over his left shoulder, and he's standing in roughly the same place. But there is one very important difference between these two images that tells you something is wrong with one or other of those images. I'll just give you a few seconds. I'm not expecting you to jump in or raise your hand. Just spend a few seconds looking at those two images. What is the obvious difference between those images that tells you something is wrong? The image on the left clearly shows the radio antenna on Aldrin's backpack, which appears to be totally absent in this picture on the right-hand side. The radio antenna must be there. It's their prime means of communication from the radio set inside their backpack. That's how they talk to each other. That's how they talk to the mothership. That's ultimately how they talk to Earth. If there was a problem with radio communication, they would have had to terminate the moonwalk. So that aerial is necessary. It's there, it's wrapped in white plastic, it's visible from all angles, and it's always sunlit. So it must be visible. But it's not there on the right-hand side, whereas it's clearly visible on the left-hand side some 2 minutes earlier. Can't possibly have snapped off because that would have been catastrophic. So there's something wrong with the missing aerial on the right-hand side. If we come back to that, we get another hint by realising that the largest black cross in the image, which should be at the centre of the image, and all images are square unless they've been cropped, that is the large black cross which should be at the centre of the image. And I think you agree, it does not appear to be at the centre of the image. And that is the second hint that tells us something is wrong with that image. It wasn't until I researched this particular talk that I found out that that is not the image of Aldrin taken by Armstrong on the surface of the moon. The actual image taken is that one. That's the actual position. That's the actual framing. Now the black cross is in the centre. I checked, it was exactly in the centre. So that is definitely the uncropped image. And you can see why the aerial is missing, because it was outside the frame. Armstrong actually took a picture of Aldrin's foot when he took that picture. Perhaps Armstrong was leaning forward slightly because, remember, they've got 100 kilograms of backpack. Yes, I know it's a sixth gravity, but still their centre of mass is such that they tend to lean slightly forward because of the weight of the backpack. And maybe Aldrin was on slightly higher ground. So the combination of various factors and the fact that Armstrong could not see the view he was taking meant that he had chopped off the aerial. NASA looked at that and thought, what a wonderful picture. That is our poster boy for the Apollo program. It's got Aldrin on the surface of the moon. It's got Armstrong reflected in his visor. It's got the lunar module reflected in the visor. It's got his shadow. Absolutely fantastic. Oh, he's cut the top of his backpack off. So they looked at the image before and the image after, and neither of them were that view. because Armstrong then went away and did what he was supposed to do, which is take pictures of other things, whether it be rocks or equipment or the lunar module or whatever. So NASA thought, that is a fantastic image, that's the one we want, but that looks crazy to have the top of his backpack cut off. Okay, we want a picture that's going to go round the world on the front cover of Time magazine, etc. Okay, what we'll do is we'll take that image and we'll add a black stripe across the top. We'll just move him down and add a black stripe across the top. No need to add any stars back in because the stars aren't visible. Fantastic, we don't have to match the star field, so job's a good one. Should we paint the antenna back in? No, no one's going to notice. It's not like 52 years later somebody is going to point out the fact, hang on a second, his antenna is missing. So they didn't bother to paint it back in. That would have been rather difficult. No Photoshop, of course. They would have had to have printed it, high quality, painted the antenna back in, and then re-photographed it to get the picture they wanted. Far too much hassle, not worth it. No one's going to notice. So how did they get perfect framing? They didn't, and that is one classic example in which NASA admitted that they doctored the image. That's the only one that I believe they have admitted that they doctored it, purely for aesthetic purposes, not to try and hoodwink anybody, but purely because they thought that that picture was better than that one. And I think most people would agree with that. You still find books, magazines, web pages, etc., that give the, whatever you want to call that, the modified version. There's a few places which will genuinely show the original image, but that's perhaps a question of personal choice. So I've taken you through a few pieces of evidence and shown you that the evidence can easily be refuted. But the question remains, if you turn it around, if any evidence presented by people who believe that the moon landings were hoax can easily be addressed, what about the opposite? Is there any evidence that can be presented beyond any reasonable doubt that the moon landings did take place? Well, proof, 100% scientific proof, is very difficult. Legal proof is easier. Scientific proof, you've got to be careful about. Beyond any reasonable doubt. That depends on your definition of reasonable. As I've said, I have found that when I'm talking to people who passionately believe in a conspiracy theory, I have found that, generally speaking, reasonable is not usually the adjective I would use. Reasonable means, given the evidence for what you believe and given the evidence against what you believe, can you make a reasoned judgment? And I have found that people who believe in conspiracy theories will be quite happy to take all the evidence that backs up their conspiracy theory, but if presented with evidence which is a counter-argument to their theory, they tend to either ignore or sweep under the carpet or simply dismiss any evidence that doesn't suit their purpose. Is this evidence?
Well, in my left hand I have a feather. In my right hand a hammer.
A hammer and a feather.
I guess one of the reasons we got here today was because of a gentleman named Galileo a long time ago who made a rather significant discovery about falling objects in gravity fields. And we thought that where would be a better place to confirm his findings than on the moon. And so we thought we'd try it here for you. The feather happens to be appropriately a falcon feather for our falcon. And I'll drop the two up here, and hopefully they'll hit the ground at the same time. How about that? Mr. Galileo was correct in his findings.
Mr. Galileo was correct. The hammer and the feather hit the ground at the same time because there's no air resistance to slow the feather down. Try that on Earth, the hammer would arrive first and the feather would take a little longer to drop the 1.5 meters or whatever it was. Is that proof? Well, you can look at it a number of different ways. It's a rather fuzzy video. How do we know that's a hammer and that's a feather? this guy works for NASA. Of course he's in on the conspiracy, so of course he would say that. How do we know the hammer wasn't made of lightweight plastic? How do we know that feather wasn't made of lead and then painted white so that they would arrive at the ground at the same time? Or if you believe that they were genuinely a hammer and a feather, how do we know that wasn't filmed in a vacuum on Earth? Would it have been possible in 1969 to take a huge tank and put an actor in there and pump it out so that the air was not going to make any difference to the video and then get the actor to do this and run the experiment again? Not impossible. So hammer and feather experiment is circumstantial evidence because it could in principle be reproduced on Earth, or you can simply say I've got no idea if that guy is telling the truth and I can't actually see that that hammer is substantially more massive than that feather. So that's not quite good enough. This is the closest I can find to actual proof beyond any reasonable doubt. This is part of a video, no soundtrack for this one, part of a video. I've got a feeling this is John Young driving the moon buggy here. And it's part of a longer video showing the astronaut traversing a quite substantial part of the moon. And although I'm not going to show you this, if you go through frame by frame of the cine, this is not video, this is cine film. If you go frame by frame through the original cine, you actually see the dust that is kicked up by the wheels. And unlike on Earth, where it would tend to billow into clouds, all of the dust grains thrown up by the wheels each follow a parabola and arrive back onto the lunar surface, indicating that there were no air molecules to disturb each little grain being thrown up and doing its own parabolic arc through the vacuum. So you could say, okay, that must have been filmed in a vacuum, but couldn't they have done this on Earth in a big vacuum chamber? Well, this is part of a video which shows the lunar rover travelling for half a kilometre or so. So if you wanted to do this on Earth and reproduce this in the 1960s, you would have to have built a vacuum tank which is half a kilometre long, tens of metres deep and tens of metres high, and then pumped it out and then, again, put an actor in there and reproduce that particular little rodeo ride on the rover. Is that possible? Well, I would argue that pumping out a volume of that size, even today, would be difficult. Pumping out a volume of that size in the 1960s would have been as close to impossible as I'm prepared to believe. In other words, it would have been more difficult to fake that video than it would to actually film it on the surface of the moon in the first place. So as close as you can get to proof. Some people say, what about these reflectors on the surface of the moon? We've been firing lasers from the Earth to the moon and timing how long it takes the light to go from the telescope to the moon and back again. And if you time how long it takes and you know how fast light travels, then you can work out the distance to the moon very accurately. That's been done essentially every night for the past 50 years or so. So we now have a huge database of understanding the distance to the moon to an accuracy of barely a few centimetres. We know the distance to various Apollo landing sites. So we know not only how the Earth is going around, how the moon is going around the Earth, we also know how the moon is nodding and wagging backwards and forwards because we have distances to more than one point on the lunar surface. So is that proof that the Apollo landings took place? Well, no, it's proof that there are laser reflectors on the surface of the moon. It's not proof that men put them there. Perhaps they were placed there by some robotic mission or some orbiter which just dropped them and hoped some of them landed the right way up. It's proof that there are these things on the surface of the moon. It is not proof that men put them there. So you can see that conspiracy theorists will always try and find an angle to say, whatever your evidence is, that's not actually proof that I'm wrong. What about get NASA to point the Hubble Space Telescope, the best telescope in the world, or outside the world. It's got fantastic resolution. Point it at the lunar landing sites, and then we'll see the lunar lander and the footprints and the flag, and then all bets are off. Then there won't be any arguments. So even though the Hubble Space Telescope was built, launched in 1990, during the last 30 years, NASA have never pointed the Hubble Space Telescope to the landing sites to show that the lunar modules are sitting there. Why is that? Well, because NASA don't want to be embarrassed by actually showing lots of pictures in which there's no lunar module, say the conspiracy theorists. Well, no, that's not quite the case. Regardless of whether you believe the moon landings or whether you don't believe the moon landings took place, everybody has to obey the laws of physics, regardless of what you believe. And the resolution of the Hubble Space Telescope is dictated by the laws of physics. If you don't like numbers, look away now. The resolution, the smallest angle that can be resolved by the Hubble Space Telescope, is given by the wavelength of light divided by the size of its mirror. Wavelength of light is about half a micron. The size of its mirror is about 2.4 meters, which tells you that the resolution of the Hubble is about 0.2 microradians. And nobody knows what radians are, so let's convert that into 10 millionths of a degree. And of course, astronomers don't work in degrees if they can work in arc seconds. So there we go. The resolution is 0.05 arc seconds. That's the smallest angle it could possibly resolve. How big does the lunar module appear to be at a distance from us to the moon? Well, the lunar module is, let's say for the sake of argument, 4 meters across, and it's at a distance of 400,000 kilometers from the Earth to the moon. So that would need a resolution of 4 divided by 400,000. That gives you 0.01 microradians, or 0.002 arc seconds. It gives you an angle which is far smaller than can be resolved by the Hubble Space Telescope. It's too small by a factor of about 30. So one way you can say it is the lunar module is too small by a factor of 30. The lunar module would have to be 100 meters across, even to show up as one pixel in the image. We're not talking footprints, we're not talking flags, we're talking about the largest object they left on the surface of the moon. Too small by a factor of 30. Turn it around. If you wanted to see an object as small as the lunar module, how big a telescope would you need? You would need a telescope with a mirror not 2.5 meters across. The mirror would have to be of order 100 meters in diameter to stand a chance of just glimpsing one pixel in the image. So that is why the Hubble Space Telescope team have never bothered pointing the Hubble at the moon. There have been orbiter images of the landing sites which claim to show footprints and flags, but that was built by NASA, so of course they're going to lie about that as well, aren't they? You can't win. I showed that image a little while ago. Let me make it a little bit bigger so you can see what's going on. The sunlight is coming over the astronaut's right shoulder, so that's producing a little bit of flare, this odd structure in the top left, and this ghostly pentagon is the shape of the iris. It's causing a ghost because of the light entering the lens. And I've adjusted the brightness and the contrast slightly so the astronaut's aerial doesn't show up too well. It's there, but it doesn't show up very well. But there is something very wrong with this image. Again, I'll just give you a few seconds to look around and see if you can figure out why this image doesn't make sense. Perhaps you've noticed, some people say, oh, it's the curvature of the reflection, it's the reflection of his arm, it's the fact that it doesn't seem to be at the right angle. No, it's even simpler than that. All Apollo missions had 3 astronauts. One stayed in the command module, 2 arrive on the surface of the moon. One astronaut we're looking at. One astronaut is taking the picture, and there's his reflection. So who is that on the left-hand side? Who is the joker who stowed away in the lunar module and came down onto the surface so that there are 3 astronauts on the surface? Surely that can never happen. That must be a fake. Well, I think I can categorically say It is a fake, and I know that because I faked it. I went to the NASA archives and I downloaded a very nice picture from Apollo 12, and the picture was that one, with a nice little gap, a little space there on the left-hand side of the reflection in his visor. And I thought, I wonder if I could put another astronaut in there. So I went to a different Apollo mission, found a picture of an astronaut in the distance. His shadow was wrong, so I turned him around. The contrast was wrong, so I made an adjustment. I placed him in the left-hand part of the visor and then tidied up the horizon in the background. And I challenge you to tell that that has been doctored. And that is the result of 3 or 4 minutes of playing around with some graphics software. I don't use Photoshop, but that's the sort of thing that I'm talking about. Some simple software that allows you to manipulate images. So that's the original, that's my version. That's the original, that's my version. It is so difficult to tell that images have been doctored now. Back in the 1960s, it would have been very difficult to doctor images. But now, you cannot believe anything that you download off the internet. There is no way to tell whether they've been doctored or not. If somebody has bothered to take the time to fake an image, it is very difficult to look at it and say, well, clearly that's not right. And of course, you know that in movies, CGI effects, whether it be superheroes or whether it be dinosaurs or whether it be interstellar space, the effects that CGI, computer-generated imagery, can produce is so good, you cannot tell it from reality. So what that means is, whenever you see an image, unless you know its provenance absolutely, you cannot tell if what you're looking at is reality or is the result of somebody's imagination. It's a bit of a shame, but that's the way it is. When I was young, I used to know if something was right because I would look it up in Encyclopedia Britannica. And if it was there, I knew it was right. Now, you cannot tell if what you're being told and what you see in images and what you see in videos is real or not. And this is a message I try and get across if I ever give this talk to school kids. Okay, what's the point? Why are there so many people who believe in conspiracy theories? Well, moon hoax is no different from JFK or the 9/11 bombings or whatever. Do they really believe their scientific evidence when they present these shadows are impossible, this can't happen, that must have been taken on Earth, not on the moon? It's difficult to tell because a lot of the evidence can very easily be countered. In some cases, it doesn't even need to be basic physics. Sometimes common sense is enough to counter the arguments and the evidence that is given. Sometimes the analysis of the evidence can make a good science lesson. I'm glad to see that some teachers actually take this as a way of teaching the scientific method. Let's have a look at this. These people claim that this evidence backs up this claim of theirs. Let's look at the evidence and see if it does actually back up that claim. And if it doesn't, then it's not permissible evidence to back up that particular hypothesis. An excellent way of teaching scientific scrutiny and scientific method. Sometimes thinking about why things might behave differently on the moon can actually help us teach physics on Earth. So, next time you see that image, if you're with somebody who hasn't heard this particular talk, next time you see that image, you can say, hey, I know that that is not the image of Aldrin taken by Armstrong on the surface of the moon. And you can tell them why. Thank you for listening.